Good evening, everybody. This is the College and Complex.
Bravo!
Silence in the ranks here. We need to announce that we are having a primary election.
No.
Use the microphone.
All right, let's get rolling. This is going okay. All right. All right, we're going to have two speakers tonight. I'll be the lead-in guy, warm-up guy. Welcoming Mike Brennan back. He's spoken before on the topic of presidential politics. Wait, what happened here?
We're very well organized.
There we go. All right. I put together a little program, an introduction, an overview of the presidential electoral process.
Yeah.
And some of this may be secondhand knowledge to a great many of you, but there's areas that I've tried to cover, and then it's going to be in two parts, the presidential process in general, followed by a look at actually the remaining candidates. At the College of Complexes, we at one time had four declared candidates for president among the student body, and we even put on a program at the Democratic National Convention in the free speech area, which got some attention. But I put together a brief PowerPoint here that covers the many aspects of what exactly is going on with this presidential process, because I know you guys are look all like this guy down here, confused, and I heard things that I just couldn't believe. But anyhow, there are about 1,513 officially declared candidates for President of the United States. There you can see the remaining Democrats and remaining Republicans. The list goes on, and plus we have three, I've tried to focus on the three primary third-party candidates. It's always a delight to see who's registered to become president of the United States. There's someone called the Ghost of Christmas Past, Zorro the Cockroach, all kinds of Jesus Christ. There's Mr. Jesus the Iron Man, Bank Ass Weed, Vladimir Putin, you may not be aware of this, is running for president. And USA Prophet, who has no numbers and figures there, and Lester D. Warlord stock. But you can go through the list if you go to the Federal Election Commission. You can see each of these candidates up there. Okay, now what is to bring you up to date? We started out, I think at one time there were 22 Republican candidates. It folk narrowed down to 17. And you can see a number of them dropped out. Lawrence Lessing, Lincoln Chaffee from Rhode Island, Loris Lessing was a techie guy, Martin Webb of Baltimore, James Webb of Virginia. But each of these have officially dropped out. Wow. So there's been a few, the weeding of the collection here. Now, one of the things that stood out about this election year was that the candidates outdid themselves on logos and graphics.
Oh, yeah.
There were all sorts of things passed around about these things that they were trying to outdo one another. A lot of them just, in previous elections, didn't pay much attention. You can buy this stuff. You can go to like a political button and poster printing companies, and all you do is put your name in there. So, like, if you wanted to run for something, you just put, they have all sorts of things. But these guys went out this year and all put together original graphics, you know. Some of them are kind of interesting here. Now, the big thing is the talk of the Super Tuesday, which we had one of them last week. And of course, the refers to any Tuesday in February or March when the great number of states hold their primary elections at the same time. Actually, a big one coming up is our own primary on March 15th, if you add up the number of delegates. Other dates that are coming up are April 26th, May 10th, 17th, and June 7th. It's really a confusing thing to try to see the calendar, because some states, like, even though they have caucuses, they have pre-primary voting and post-primary voting, and I don't know what they're doing in some states. There's no lack of standardization, or total lack of standardization, at least among the Republicans. But anyhow, you can see the primary that's coming up that they're going to be taking pretty seriously. Okay, now, what happens? You're voting for candidates, and either it's a winner-take-all, and we'll get into that later, or proportion. And if some, we'll give you the figures on this, but if then no candidate gets enough to win on the first ballot, you end up with what is called a brokered convention. And this wasn't talked about until quite recently in some of these things regarding Mr. Trump. Normally, brokered conventions are avoided, and we haven't seen one in a long, long time. The last one in the Democrats was 1952 with Adlai Stevenson. And then we had Dewey in 48 for the Republicans. So they're very rare and not too common. And the last winning candidate, just keep in mind, that came out of brokered convention was Franklin Roosevelt in 1832. 1932. And I believe another person who won the presidency out of the brokered convention was Abraham Lincoln. So it can happen. Whoops.
Coffee? Is that backyard dealing and wheeling?
Okay. And here we go. And I told you, you have to get. Now, there's each party makes up its own set of rules on this whole delegation process and the primary process. These are not governed by laws. These are not governed by the Federal Election Commission. There's no legislation governing this. However they choose to do it is their own set of rules. And the delegates for each state are awarded to such things like if you have a Democratic governor, you might get two delegates. If you have a senator from that state, you might get another delegate. They reward you for being good Democrats or Republicans. And then you have the other category of the ones that you're voting for, the unspoken for delegates. So there's two things in here. So you have something like a balance between the establishment candidates and those who choose to run, get the signatures, and get their name on the ballot. In the Republicans, you need 1,237 votes. That's 50% plus one, out of a total of about 2,500 delegates. And the Democrats, you need 2,382. So they have a big, larger convention, and they have 712 superdelegates, and pledged and committed are 4,000. That means on the first ballot, you have to vote the name, if you go to register to vote for somebody, it'll be the name Susie Jones, and then the name of the candidate she's representing. So after the first vote, they're free to go on. Now here's where we stand right now, as of this morning. And you can see that they've got a ways to go. Trump is at 329. The others aren't terribly far behind. And then the Democrats, because they have the two different systems, you can see that Hillary is not quite halfway there. So, and Sanders is about a fourth of the way there. And you can see, now the color list, I tried to make that larger, but it shows in there, what I was mentioning, there'll be more Super Tuesdays coming up. And you can see that there's quite a few votes. The voting goes on through June, just before the conventions in July. Okay, now one of the things, our questions that comes up, is how influential are the third parties on this? We've been talking about Democrats and Republicans. And there you can see where the Green Party is already on the ballot, and the Libertarians, the other primary third party that's been out there. This means they have ballot status. The Green Party in Illinois lost the ballot status because they weren't drawing in enough votes for their candidates. If you don't do that, you can lose ballot status. So they have to start all over again. They had a meeting today. You don't even have to go through the primary process. A political party, in fact, can do it all by themselves, and then just notify the Board of Elections who they chose. So some of the people say, oh, they want all the democracy and voting and so forth, but technically, and that's actually what the Greens were talking about today, was they said, why don't we just forego this primary process, since we don't really have contested elections among ourselves, and simply notify who the party, you know, has chosen to run. So you can see now what they're looking for in total is 538 electoral votes in order to become president of the United States. There's only two states. It's a winner take all, except for like Nebraska and one other state that does it by congressional district. So, all right, some of the other third parties. I love third parties. We used to, I used to try to invite them to come talk to the college here. But I have no idea what the Nutrition Party is up to. but they are working on influencing 9 electoral votes. It sounds like they're in one state. America's Party, these come and go. The Prohibition Party. Actually, the Socialist Party USA, we'll see later. They've been around for a long time. Workers' World Party, relatively new to me. That's the commies. Okay, you can see. Now we're going to bounce around a few aspects of the election here. But the U.S. presidential elections have been turned into garish media circuses. Lasting as long as 2 years. This is incredible. These are the longest and most expensive elections of any nation. And in order to become president of the United States, which I know you all aspire to be, you will need about $1 billion in order to become president of the United States. So all this talk about, oh, capitalism is, you know, a decisive factor there. And this is figures been floating around here. This has been verified several times. I keep coming across this figure. About 158 families or the corporations they control. Thus far, they've paid about half of the primary expenses. So believe you me, they're the ones that are naming the tune. All right, one thing that we always see when we're following presidential politics are these these opinion polls. This one turned out okay, though. But the early polls are basically, I'll still have to read all this, but they're virtually no good. They're worthless as predictors of the outcome. They capture only a few aroused and assertive people out there in the body politic. And most of the electorate the electorate is not even engaged yet. So you see, I saw one. Actually, I kept changing them, and I put it together, and I finally gave up on it because they just were getting meaningless. Most voters, and seriously, the thing about this, aren't paying attention. So you should be credited for coming out tonight, and listening to an expert, and this stuff. But only 10 to 20% of the voters are really following these campaigns. Okay, wanted to bring you up to date nationwide. This is hot off the press. Brand new figures, though, that I wanted to compare. I narrowed it down to three primary candidates, Hillary, Sanders, and Trump. And you can see that they're both polling at about the same, defeating Mr. Trump were the election to be held today. And you can see that Hillary and Sanders are running about neck to neck. So anything less than 10% is considered de minimis, not significant. That's pretty tight. The latest ones, now this is really out of date. This goes all the way back to June, but this is what the Illinois people are up to here. And since this was in June, we have large numbers of undecided voters. But still you can see that, actually I was amazed at this figure, Mr. Sanders seemed to have name recognition among the voters of Illinois, enough sufficient that it was equal to that of Hillary. So it's rather fascinating little figure here. But they're virtually about the same in terms of the votes here. Now, a lot of the things you hear about we don't pay attention to are the endorsements. And if you want to get an endorsement from the independent voters of Illinois, one of the things, the very beginning of our questionnaire is, we ask who has endorsed you. And a lot of this has symbolic meaning, but I always am impressed by legitimate, serious candidates that will often have two or three pages of people presently in office and so forth who they've given their nod to as being credible candidates. It's probably good for free advertising. It's an easy way to get some advertising. And I think you are all aware what candidate with Mr. Cruz is outstanding, that even though he was a member of the Senate of the United States, could not get one endorsement of a fellow colleague or co-worker in the United States Senate. I think he picked up the governor of Maine, who is nuts, and one other endorsement. But he just has not been successful, which has to tell you something, like it's some indication that he's had some difficulty here. He's not a personable, sociable kind of guy like me, I can get along with anybody, right? You'd endorse me, wouldn't you? Anyhow, another thing, you'll switch here. Now, all these, you're talking about your debate watch, Don, but there's no correlation between the alleged winner of a debate and the winner of the presidency. These things are just kind of an exercise, and most of the people who watch them, it's been found, already have their minds made up. And so they're just looking for something incorrect to be said, or, it's good citizenship, but they really don't have much influence on the, I guess the Republicans are calling it quits on their debates, because the last one got into kind of like they were saying bad things. Talking about private parts and stuff. Shame. All right, let's look at quickly. I won't take all your time. I got to move here. Let's look around. That's like you guys. Who do I vote for, Chuck? All right, I left these in here simply because they were in here when I did this. Jeb Bush, who never had more than a 3% chance of winning. By those in the know, I like it. Those who didn't come out with this logo, then they started mucking around with it. I still like the time he gave a speech, and there was total silence afterwards. He said, "Could you please clap?" That happened to another candidate, the guy from Tennessee.
You know what? Mom was great. We had enough horses.
Okay. But he spent a lot of money, more than any other candidate in Iowa. He got 2.8% of the vote for spending $14 million. About $2,800 votes. I don't know if you saw this. He was sending like tape recorders so you could listen to his speech. And it just was incredible. Oh, this one I love. They started, I don't know if you can read in there, but it says on the gun, Governor Jeb Bush.
Oh, yeah, Governor.
He sent out a photo of his own gun so that
yeah.
NRA, yeah, he's a gun. Yeah, get rid of them people, you know, gun control people.
Yeah.
Now, another candidate, that I really kind of going to miss this guy. Yes, Dr. Karsten. You know, actually, he did have this thing where he would answer questions from time to time. Somehow, being a neurosurgeon, he felt automatically qualified in the run for president. He came up with, he started getting off in the, such divergent areas, saying that God and evolution are mutually exclusive. I don't know why, oh yeah, the Christians were on his case. He just had so many quotes from this guy. Obamacare was slavery. There should not be rules for the military like the Geneva Conventions. And what was that, the one he said, people can absolutely choose to be gay or straight. You just decide, you know. I want to be like gay, you know. Or but there's a little bit more there. He got into climate change. He said he didn't know. Temperature goes up, temperature goes down. and just the way the earth rotates on its axis, you know. This guy wants to be president, you know. What do you think of global warming? Well, temperature goes up, temperature goes down. Oh, and then the rookie, little Marco. Try seriously. I like Marco, first term senator. Unfortunately, his campaign staff, they didn't do their homework. He was attacking Cruz for voting a certain way and on a vote that Marco wasn't even in the Senate to vote on. So you really can't accuse the other guy. He also got caught in this mix-up saying whether or not Obama was competent or not. But let's see. Another guy, Kasich, is a strange guy. He's kind of like not talking the issues. It's kind of like humanistic stuff, like feel good kind of humanism or something. And I think he studied at one time for the clergy. They may be getting a little preachy, but I think he's positing himself as the great reconciler among all this turmoil and the voice of clearness, things like that. Far from it. This guy's a son of a bitch, if there ever was. He is a dick. He's just like this guy they had in Wisconsin. He tried to bust the unions for 350,000 employees in Ohio, and he got beat. They put it on a referendum, and they said, as a matter of fact, he was way down in the polls. And they even went so far as to say if the re-election was held, His opponent would have beat him by 25%. They have no use for this guy in Ohio. It's my turn. It's my turn, Mike. If you don't mind, we'll schedule you for another time.
It's okay.
All right. Now another guy is Mr. Cruz.
When I say sodomy, it's no good.
All right, will you beat it, please? All right, Mr. Cruz. The guy who shut down the government of the United States. We're going to have a lot of fun with Mr. Cruz, and it only takes a few minutes. This guy is the least trustworthy and accurate in terms of information. Over half the things he says are absolutely categorically not true or accurate.
Is he a liar?
Yes.
Hey, what fool is
are you going over?
But he'll do anything to get a vote and say anything. He's been wearing his religion on his sleeve. The major thing, he's always promoting this, and it's called a lunatic scheme or something. What do they call it? Not far-reaching, but kind of loony. This thing about getting rid of the IRS with a flat tax. And we had them here at the college, you know. It's just... This guy's something else, though. All right, of course, they were having a field day. It's kind of quieted now that he's not eligible to be president of the United States because of his Canadian heritage. Actually, it kind of looks like his parents had settled in Canada. But they had, actually, I think they had marital difficulties, and that's, his wife moved back. They had a separation. He's noted for this thing. Now, what happened? And all the stories that Ben Carson said maybe to somebody that he was going to go home to his home in Florida after the caucuses in Iowa for a day or two and get a change of clothes and, I don't know, get his mail, you know. But the Cruz campaign put this out and embellished it. You can see the message there. They put out a press thing and message that he was quitting the campaign. He wasn't just going home. He was quitting the campaign and don't bother voting for him because he's out of the race. It was absolutely categorically false. This is dirty politics. And he caught it on this, rightfully so. But there's the message and the text that he sent out. The other thing he did at the same time was he sent these things to candidates. Totally bogus notices that the voters who were somehow in difficulty on the basis of their voting records. They had accurate names and the names of your neighbors, but the data that they were presenting was identical for everybody. Were switched around, there were like three different ones. It was totally phony. You better get out to the caucus to improve your score, your voting record. And you can see there, it was a voting fraud. Voting violation there, you can't really see it, but those are some of the figures, the names of your neighbors, if you get one of these. This happened, there was something like this, in the one election here, we had them here, the Illinois ballot, where they were sending things out. That's right. If you wanted to vote by mail, Gary, you were talking about voting by mail. They were sending everyone this thing. It looked like it came from the Board of Elections. It actually came from one of the campaigns and said, if you want to vote by mail, contact me or us. And you were contacting one of the campaigns. Yeah, phony, yeah. Now the other thing, I better hurry up. Cruz found Jesus, and he said, I'm going to clean this up. And he fired a guy, but he didn't fire the guy that was responsible for this. The other thing I was going to say about Cruz, or about my pal Carson, it's coming out now. They kind of took him, these political operatives and campaign guys, but I think he was a little upset. I mean, they delivered a good campaign, but it's kind of expensive. Cruz wasn't done, and I don't know if you've seen this picture here of Marco and his good friend Obama, which is a silly picture here that they were putting out, that he's got a deal with his pal Obama. One other thing about Cruz, I told you you can't trust this guy. He said he's going to increase military spending. He's going to spend over $2.6 trillion on the military. Well, that's three times more money than it to fix the entire infrastructure all over the United States. That's, I mean, what is this, research figures? Is this accurate data or just numbers? You know, I mean, this astronomical amount of money. So, you know, even if you look, anyone that knows the budget, say, this guy's like nuts. You know, what's he talking about? All right, I'll hurry up here. I won't spend a lot of time on Trump. He's got too much attention already. He came out of the birther movement. Andy Martin was largely responsible for the birther movement. He's been here at the college. He's now moved out east. But he was the guy that even went to Hawaii. And Trump was pushing this. He's noted for his insults. I like that when they pushed the homeless guy, they beat up that guy at his rally, and he said, oh, my supporters are very passionate. They beat the bejeebies out of the guy. Oh, see, I haven't seen her lately, but Katrina Pearson is his major spokesperson, who wore this necklace of bullets.
Oh, no.
And we had one of that woman that was here, that libertarian speaker, was just like her on Agenda 21. She thought this was her job, going around the country warning us about the United States taking over the United Nations is taking over the world. And she actually felt that our time was limited, that the UN was taking over. And notice a few other things about Trump. If you think he's a great friend of the little guy and the little person, his tax plan, which is amazing because you can't find any details what this guy's talking about, but his tax plan would save the rich guys about $275,000, more than 100 times the idiots who show up at his rallies. Cruz is just as bad. In his crackpot scheme. Oops.
I want to bring up something that happened just recently. Trump was fighting.
All right. One cool time. Save it for the moms.
His hotels.
All right.
One bull at a time!
All right, we better move on. Save it for the rebuttal.
Yeah.
All right. Quickly now, I found this kind of interesting. Who are the supporters for Trump? What's the demographics of our electorate here? These are people that like Confederate flags, think the South, wish the South had won the Civil War, want to get rid of gays, and want a national database of Muslims, you know.
Yeah.
And they believe Islam should be illegal in the United States. That's probably not a bad idea, you know. Now, I'm almost done. One guy you may not have heard of is Mr. Gilmore.
Yeah.
Now, Mr. Gilmore, the former governor of Virginia.
I'm just reminded of you, Charlie. Make Islam illegal. You just said it, Charlie, when you said it in front of a camera.
One fool at a time. One fool at a time.
I have very passionate supporters. What can I say? That's a bit of all right, but Mr. Gilmore, I love this. He was in New Hampshire, though.
Hey, Tim.
And he spent
a hundred.
Are you going to have that over? to put it on the website? Charlie said Muslims should be illegal. Are you going to edit that up? Put it on the website.
One fool at a time.
He's serving the restaurant. I think we're going to have to, if he gets one more.
No.
All right, but anyhow, Jim Gilmore is still running, and but in New Hampshire, he spent $9,000, $9,100 per vote, which is astronomical. Last of all, Hillary, if you go to her website, she's got a biography that's great reading, how she was inspired as a young girl for civil rights and all those such wonderful things. It's good reading, you know. No sooner did she come out, I mentioned the logos. Everybody and their brother was redesigning this Hillary H. You know, some of them are pretty cool, but there's still more and more of these coming out every day. Regarding Bernie's, Bernie came out of the 50 activists of the Occupy movement to a large extent. Of course, Bernie had been in Congress for many years, first in the House and later in the Senate. And of course, the question was everybody ready for Hillary, which was her campaign slogan. And I went to one or two of her events, very nice, they gave me a nice lunch and a free shirt, which I still have someplace. But anyhow, here you go. That's two old socialists. Anyhow, if you want to volunteer, there's offices around town. One right on Roosevelt, one up in Evanston, and on the south side. And you can find these. Another guy, his commercials are running every now and then on Fox or MSNBC. So he's got some money. Willie Wilson, he ran for mayor in Chicago, got 10% of the vote. But anyhow, he is running. Amazingly, I'm up on his website. I had a hard time at first ascertaining what office he was running for. I'm not kidding you. I had to dig around. I said, I know he's running. It doesn't say even on his commercial what he's running for. That's what sparked my curiosity. And I said, his website, I got the logo someplace else. I had to Google it. I go, he's running, but I don't know what for. All right, another one. She's in town this week in Chicago. Jill Stein ran on the Green Party. She's got a Green New Deal. We're going to have a Green speaker next week, so we'll have some literature about her campaign next week. Libertarians, two-time governor of New Mexico, Gary Johnson. He was term limited out, so now he's running. He's notorious for vetoing something like 950 pieces of legislation in succession. Oh, so the Socialist Party. I get these. The guy's name is Mimi. Running, he's got some neat things there. He just says that even if he gets elected, he'd resign because something out of the job ain't worth it. Quotes, they've been doing this now, and it's been running like every week, the 10 or 20 quotes of the candidates. And Donald Trump, this one I like, claimed at one time, I watched him say this, that the gross domestic product of the United States had fallen to absolute zero, and absolutely nothing was being produced in the United States. No goods or services. We'd become one vast economic desert. I said, that's amazing. You think it'd be on the evening news. All right, immigrants, Bush said immigrants are more fertile than the rest of us. That's why they have large families. I love these guys. I get these every week. They collect them, the guys. Ron Paul said just because a couple of people on the Supreme Court declare something constitutional doesn't make it so. Well,
yeah.
Oh, and Marco said he's uncertain if the earth was created in 7 days or in seven eras. He says this is one of life's great mysteries. Oh, and my friend Dr. Ben, who says, yes, what do you think you need to do in order to become president? He said you gotta have a brain.
That's right.
And argue with that one.
Nope.
All right, anyhow, thanks a lot. It's all yours, Phil. Hope you enjoyed it.
Let's turn off that projector, Charlie.
Does this mic make any difference?
Yes, it does. Turn off the projector.
What? All right, thank you. I'm glad to be back with you because I've got some very important news that you may already know, but it's so important that I'm going to say it. And that is that this election can have a big effect on your health, your brain, your body, and I'm going to explain a little bit why. But first of all, let's start out with one of the major issues and one of the biggest reasons that Bernie Sanders was going to be the best person to protect your health.
Yeah, I can't hear over here.
Can't hear over here, I'm sorry. Can you hear all right back there?
No.
No? Well, how's this? Quiet. Is this any better?
No, about a fist away from your mouth.
Like that?
No,
about a fist away. I thought you said fish.
No. About a fist away from
okay.
your mouth.
Okay, like this?
A little more.
Like that?
Yeah.
Okay, that's better? Okay, good to be here. All right, here's what I want to point out.
Where's the microphone?
Under Obamacare, or Affordable Care Act, and maybe the best they could get at the time, I'm not blaming them, but there are going to be, even in the year 2025, 52 million people in this country without health insurance. And this translates into thousands of people dying every year for lack of health insurance. If you put them in caskets and put them in a line, they would reach from here all the way out to O'Hare Airport every year. That many deaths. And who's got the answer to that? You probably know Bernie Sanders is working and fighting for Medicare for all ages. And by that, I don't mean just the ordinary Medicare. His plan, and you can get it on the web, and I've got some material for you on it in one of my pages. His plan covers all eye problems, ear problems, teeth problems, as well as long-term care. And if you probably heard people say, oh, he can't afford it, or whatever. I'd suggest you go to PolitiFact. It's a neutral fact reviewer, and find out what they say, because I've looked at a lot of sources. Hey, wouldn't it figure that you could save money when an insurance company gets your dollar, 80 to 85 cents goes into healthcare. When Medicare gets your dollar, 98 cents goes into healthcare. So there's a big savings when you don't have red tape and golden parachutes from the insurance companies. So that's a very big difference between the candidates, is that one candidate, Bernie Sanders, would go for healthcare for all. This has been proven to work. In other countries, physicians have gone around the world and looked at these systems, and they find that people are satisfied and they get high quality. And even in this country, the Princeton Survey Research found that they compared people who were Medicare as opposed to private insurance. The people were feeling better about being able to pay their bills even though they were poor if they had Medicare. So this is a lifesaver. Thousands of people would live that are not going to live if we have this continuing the same system. And again, I really recommend go to the neutral sources to figure out how much it's going to cost. Nobody knows exactly. All right, so that's one big difference between the candidates. Very big difference. The next big difference I want to bring up is this. I want to read you something briefly. It's about air pollution. We don't usually think of air pollution as being linked with Alzheimer's or brain problems. I could read you from a lot of studies. I don't think I will, though, because I don't have two hands to do that with, or three hands, I should say. So I won't read those studies. But I, if anybody wants the citations, I testified before this, before the Environmental Protection Agency, and I've got a lot of quotes from people that do the research. Link between brain deficiencies, memory problems, and Alzheimer's and air pollution. And air pollution is very wide in this country. And here's a great way to compare the candidates. the League of Conservation Voters looks at how the candidates have voted on different issues. And in the League of Conservation Voters that they've looked at, in 2015, we got three senators that we can look at for their votes on 20 key votes. That is Cruz, Rubio, and Sanders. Cruz and Rubio did not vote once for the environment. Zero out of 20 votes. Sanders voted 100%, 20 votes out of 20. So if you want to protect your air, and one study says that air pollution kills about 80,000 Americans a year. So those are two. Now, when you say, well, what about Trump? Well, you read what the League of Conservation says about Trump. Trump would like to either abolish or cut the Environmental Protection Agency. They're very scared. I got a letter from the Environmental Protection Agency. They're very, I mean, from the League of Conservation Voters. They're very scared about that particular eventuality of a Trump president. And what about climate change? Well, I got, you know, let me, I got to read you this.
I just closed it for you.
Well, okay.
Stick the microphone in that little, no, that little thing in front
okay.
there.
Okay.
Yeah. We can hear you.
Climate change. A warming of the climate. Can you hear me all right now?
Yes, better.
A warming of the climate by just 1.5 degrees centigrade would lead to major changes affecting human societies. Food resources would diminish. Several contagious diseases sensitive to temperature would increase. And population migrations triggered by climate change would bring about much conflict. The number of refugees would be around the 200 million mark. So you want to know what the Republican candidates say about climate change?
No such
Donald
thing.
Trump. Donald Trump says this, I'm not a believer in man-made. Look, this planet is so massive, and when I hear Obama saying that climate change is the number one problem, it is just madness. Here's Ted Cruz, the guy with 0 for 20 records. If you look at satellite data for the last 18 years, there's been zero recorded warming. They're cooking the books. They're actually adjusting the numbers. I don't know, maybe he's communicating with some people on another planet to give this information. Jim, oh no. Marco Rubio, I do not believe that human activity is causing these dramatic changes to our climate. So that's the scary part. Think of any of those people as president. Very scary. So for the environment itself, oh, by the way, Bernie Sanders' lifetime record for legal conservation voters, can you hear me any better?
Yeah, just.
Okay. His lifetime record is 95%, and Hillary's is 82%. So, but compared to Cruz and Rubio and Trump, you know, watch out. So now, I want to give you some other numbers from a, you've heard of Project Vote Smart, and now they're called Vote Smart, and I can tell you more about it, but I can just say this. There's a fascinating website they have called Vote Easy. You know about that?
Oh, I thought it was votesmart.org, no?
That's it. You got it.
Votesmart.org
and go to Vote Easy. And they have a whole list of questions you can ask all the candidates. And when they answer the way you want them to answer, their picture gets bigger. And if they answer some other way, their picture gets small. And you guess who had the biggest pictures? Clinton and Sanders. But let me give you some of the answers and see what you think about their answers. They're scary. Some of the answers are scary. I'm not going to give you Kasich because it seems like he's out of the race. If anybody wants it later, see me. In order to balance the budget, do you support an income tax increase on any tax bracket? Any. Sanders, yes. Clinton, yes. Trump, no. Cruz, no. Rubio, no. Again, Charles pointed out how their tax plans give more money to the rich, their tax breaks. Crime, do you support mandatory criminal minimum sentences for nonviolent drug offenders? Sanders, no. Clinton, no. Cruz, no. Rubio, no. Kasich, no. And Trump is a question mark. Economy, do you support federal spending as a means of promoting economic growth? Sanders, yes. Clinton, yes. Trump, Cruz, and Rubio, no. Energy, do you support funding for the development of renewable energy, that is, solar, wind, thermal? Sanders, yes. Clinton, yes. Trump and Cruz, no. Rubio, yes. Environment, do you support the federal regulation of greenhouse gas emissions? Sanders, yes. Clinton, yes. Trump, Cruz, and Rubio, no. Guns, do you generally support gun control legislation? Sanders, yes. Clinton, yes. Trump, no. Cruz, no. Rubio, no. Maybe because those bullets around that woman's... You remember that? That's a one sign. That's a good symbol. By the way, we've heard about Bernie Sanders. Clinton said things about his record. His record from the National Rifle Association, 14%, yes. He's got a rating of 14% from the National Rifle Association. All right. Social Security, do you support allowing individuals to divert a portion of their Social Security into taxes, into personal retirement accounts? In other words, privatized. Sanders, no. Clinton, no. Trump, no. Cruz, yes. Rubio, yes. And here's the question, the one question where Hillary and Bernie differ. Do you support targeting, which is another word for killing, suspected, not proven, suspected terrorists outside of official theaters of conflict? And Bernie says no. Clinton says yes. That is scary. How many of you have seen the new award-winning documentary called Drone? Well, you missed a really powerful thing. Our drones in Yemen and in Pakistan. We don't just get the actual terrorists. We get some suspects plus some children, some women, plus some innocent men. That's what happens. Our drones hover over these places. They have some data that this person seems to fit the profile of a terrorist. We don't know if he is a terrorist or not. And so down comes they kill him. And they kill, I'm sorry.
I'm going to replace batteries.
Oh, good. Meanwhile, I'll go up closer to you then.
Oh, you're replacing them. Just stay right.
You hear me all right?
Because I'm going to keep you on camera.
Oh, okay. I'll stay back here. Well, when you're ready, I'll come back. Okay. All right. So could you imagine in this country, if we had some foreign country with drones circling around overhead, and they decided that there's a suspect in the middle of your house, and so they decided to destroy your house, or destroy you as you walk down Michigan Avenue, what would we think about that country? That's you know, and one of the persons in the movie was a former staff for Colin Powell. Here's what he says. He says, this is Colonel Lawrence Wilkerson. He says, tell me how we're winning when every time we kill 4 terrorists, we create 10.
Okay. Now, you want to stay there, that's fine.
All right. So, it isn't like Bernie Sanders says no drones in any circumstances. I don't know. I haven't seen the actuals. Okay. Oh, too close. Is that right?
Yeah, just a little farther.
Hey, may I?
Like that?
Let's turn off the microphone and I don't think it's helping.
Really?
Yeah, I don't think it's adding anything.
It's not. We can all hear you in this room very well.
Okay, is that all right? I'm getting, okay.
That's better.
All right.
What's the matter with that? Very good.
And there's some good news about winnability. I think Charles touched on that, even though we can't count on those polls. But I've looked at 10 polls in which...
More volume.
Okay, more volume. Okay, I've looked at 10 polls, 11 polls, where Bernie ran against Trump. He won those 11 polls by an average of 8%, 8.2%. Hillary ran in 15 polls against Trump, and she won against Trump by an average of about 6.7%. So that's some good news. But again, we don't count on it. Don't wait for it. it's not enough to rest our laurels.
We're trying to kill the nuts in there.
Oh, here's one other big difference, I think, for between the candidates. You know, the minimum wage in this country is 7.25%. 7.25%, believe it. Hillary would raise it in about 5 years to $12. Bernie would raise it to $15.
Yeah.
And according, I looked at figures from the Economic Policy Institute, and they say that in the Chicago area, for someone who is running or has a family, and you have both adults working, they work all year long except for 2 weeks of vacation. They work 40 hours a week. To get by, two adults with one child, they would need $15.90. So, you know, $12 an hour? Come on. I mean, especially when you have all these years to adjust. You know, they always say, you're going to destroy jobs. Actually, I looked at a study that compared the states that raised their minimum wage to the states that did not raise their minimum wage, and they found that job growth was bigger in the states that raised their minimum wage than in the states that did not. So these are some considerations I hope you can take into account when you vote. And I've got some material back on the back page. I hope you take some and pass it on to your friends and colleagues, because I think there's a lot of people who don't really know how serious this election is. They don't really know what air pollution does to your brain and your body, and how the wrong candidate in there is going to mess us up big. And even the whole question of global warming. Do you heard how they just are unaware of global warming? They have a science that comes from outer space, apparently, that, if any at all. So please, I would urge you, you know, we have our primary coming up. If you know somebody in another state, you want me to email you, I can send you documents if you want me to send them on to somebody else. Or if you want me to send them to you, you can share them on Facebook, some of that same material. Please contact me. I'll be happy to cooperate with you, because this was a really dangerous time for us. A really dangerous time. If we don't do something, our air, our climate, our salary, you've heard from Charles some of the strange things they're saying, and that's only part of it. We have a separate time for questions,
well,
right?
Are you pretty
almost
much
almost done? I just wanted to say, imagine how good you'd feel if your efforts would help make sure that we get a president who is going to really look out for us.
Yeah.
That takes money from not just any person that we can't look at his speeches later on to see what they said, but takes money from people instead of from big corporations. Just think of how good you'd feel if you shared information with people and helped them to understand what's at stake, that our air, our brains, our whole livelihood. I mean, the fact that all this money keeps going up to the top, and that you've got a group of candidates that want more of it to go to the top, and that don't even care about our air, and that don't talk about, you know, environment as far as, you know, anything else. You know, air pollution, any kind of environmental question, it affects all of us. Nobody knows when you're going to be the one that's going to breathe in that junk. It's a very scary time, but I've got pages on the back there, and if you want to go to Vote Easy, I've made copies of a few of those statements that I just read you about. You know, if you want to encourage people to go there. I'm also an ambassador for Vote Smart. I said I'd be an ambassador because I think it's really important that people go to that site, because you'll see the candidates, the, you know, big, those are the ones for you, the little tiny pictures, Rubio, Cruz, Trump, those are the ones to watch out for. And then more people that can go to that site, votesmart.org. And also look at some of that literature I've got on there. And also, if you want to help, as Charles says, they have offices, but you don't even have to go anywhere. You go to berniesanders.com. And they've got a lot of ways you can make phone calls from your home or do something from your home. Because a lot of people don't realize, you know, there's so much drama with Trump. They just, you know, they dismiss what's going on, the danger we face. So thank you for your listening, and I hope sometime we'll all get together and celebrate that we had something to do with a new president that really cares about people, Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
to questions?
Yes.
All right.
It doesn't work.
About how many people here have some question to ask? One, two. Raise your hand. One, two, three, four, five.
Nice to say answer these questions.
Yes.
All right.
Okay, so
should I call on someone? Is that the idea?
No, Brahm's going to do it for you.
Jonathan Barton.
Last October, there was a hospital that was bombed in Afghanistan.
Turn it off, Charlie. Just turn it off.
Have any candidates given a comment to this, at least on record, as to what their feelings were on it and how they see the abusive, out of control nature of the military-industrial complex in the United States leading us on a collision course over the cliff?
Good question, and I don't have a specific answer. I think there have been some statements of regret, but I'm not sure who said it. I never heard anybody justify it, but then again, I haven't heard everything said.
Just as a follow-up, or the 2014 assault on Palestine. Has anybody commented of any of the candidates on that? Has anyone asked that question at any of the debates yet?
I haven't heard it.
All right. Just him.
I'd like to know if you see anything good out of capitalism at all.
Well, sure. Well, everybody should be able to start their own business and be free of a minimum number of regulations. All I'm asking is let those who have more help more. In other words, let every capitalist treat their workers fairly.
All right. Done.
Okay. All right. I wanted to ask you is, Mike, has Trump said anything about health care, what he would do as president in terms of health care?
Yeah, actually, it's a good point that he has a plan, and I'm trying to figure it out. Somebody commented on saying that there's nothing new. But there's a lot of things. He keeps, the one thing that's very clear is he keeps the private insurance companies in it. And
okay.
He talks about letting insurance off of their cross borders, state borders. That idea has been around by Republicans.
Oh.
He's been flipping around then.
Okay.
Even said the single payer was a good idea. Now he gets called in. No, that was quite recently.
Yeah, that's right.
And he gets called in by his campaign, and then the next day it's denied or something else.
Okay.
It's basically, we're going to fix it.
Okay.
And did you guys by any chance see the Republican guy that got up there and gave his testimony on his on Obamacare?
No.
It was a young man, and he gave a biography. The president was speaking, and he said, I was anti-Obama. I worked assiduously against him. I was very much against Obamacare, and then I was diagnosed with an illness for which the insurance would not cover until Obamacare was passed. He said, because of that, I'm able to give this speech here today. He said, otherwise, it would no longer be possible. But he's flipping around. They don't have any specific. I skipped over the slide. I've been getting Trump's emails. And the only thing in his emails are his schedule of appearances.
Oh.
I think I skipped over that. You didn't see it. There's no editorial content other than he's going to be in Topeka on Tuesday at 3 o'clock and then the next day and so forth. That's all you get.
Well, what can I add to that? That yes, Trump has a position. I made a Word document of it. If you'd like me to email you a document, the Trump position on his health care plan, if you want to look at it. I also know that he did praise the single-payer system in Canada and in Scotland, but then he says it doesn't work for us. That's what those is about. I didn't try to keep track of all the details. I figured the insurance companies are in there, and with the insurance companies, you know, it's like this. How would you feel like jumping out of a plane and knowing that your parachute, you might have 25% chance of not being able to open it? There was a Consumer Reports study of people
with private health HMOs. And they divided them into the top HMOs, the middle, and the bottom. In the top rated HMOs, of the people that had serious illness, 25% of those people said they had trouble getting the care they needed. 25%, that's like jumping out of a plane with your parachute. I think I can get it to work. You know, they had trouble. So that's the risk of a private insurance company.
One another question. Yes, go ahead.
Oh, Bill West.
About 10 years ago, I came across a group in Arlington Heights that had some data about the landing and takeoff pads of O'Hare Field having a lot more air pollution than you expect. Is there any way we could get an effective campaign going to deal with these landing pads?
That's a great idea.
Jack of the, where's the, what's his name? Jack is in our College of Complex's Yahoo group with AER Co. And he occasionally said, he spoke here at the college. And the other guy, the flight people, spoke on that.
Fair Runway Coalition.
Yeah. But Jack is on our College of Complex's Yahoo group, which I recommend to all of you. And if you have any questions, he posts things from time to time, not too often. But he's part of the group, and if you have any questions about that. And we have a little side group on transportation and airplanes and pollution. So.
Okay. Next part of the military industrial complex. They're not going to.
All right, Tim Bolger.
The one thing I will say, there's more particulate matter coming out of an airplanes, which are not regulated, than all the leaves of grass on Earth. And an airplane is like a flying gas station on fire.
You know, I've often found it amazing. You guys want to, all the environmentalist candidates, they want to shut down industry, they want to conserve power, they think that wind and solar is going to do it all. But personally, I like flying a plane, I like driving my car vast distances. How are you going to accommodate a desire like this with the same environmentalist cleanup things?
Places.
Good question. I think once they are working on electric cars for one, that's one, I don't know if it's the answer, but that's one way.
Okay.
And as far as planes, I don't know how you make them clean, but I don't think anybody's seriously saying we will not fly anywhere anymore.
Well, may I say something?
Sure.
If high-speed rail, what Mike Lehman's been advocating, would reduce the demand for air travel.
Right.
It wouldn't eliminate it altogether, but it would offer, as Mike says, alternatives. That's all I wanted to say.
Butler? One thing that's rarely mentioned, but it has been an option, and it has been an option used for medium-sized trips across the United States or to Canada or whatever. What about dirigibles? They were used very successfully, up until the Hindenburg, when they realized that they had to use a different type of gas. Once they realized that, blimps, dirigibles, both became very workable. Why are we concentrating on fuel-guzzling aircraft when we could have dirigibles going between Chicago and Springfield, between Chicago and St. Louis, between Chicago and, you get the idea.
Yeah, and they're carrying it, all 8, maybe 10 passengers.
Why would you have maybe 10 passengers?
They don't lift. There's a one or two guys who are trying contemporary modern design dirigibles.
Called the Zeppelin NT.
Is it? Yeah, but
new technology.
I don't think they had much lift power versus, and then you had the energy expended in making it and things like that.
It takes just as much energy to make a dirigible as it takes to make an airplane. And as a matter of fact,
the Hindenburg and a few other aircraft of blimps of that vintage, pardon me, dirigibles, blimps or something else, of that vintage carried a lot more than a dozen passengers.
I have a model of a blimp, and I can program the lettering in there, so I could put stuff, like it floats around, it says vote for Chuck, I put in there. It has a message.
That's a fine campaign tool, whoever decides to run for president. And I can use a dirigible to take a quick flight out of the country
when
that happens.
All right, Carl.
And one of Charlie's graphics there, he had that the super delegates were almost like 25% of the total delegates needed to win the Democratic nomination. If all these people are already voted or whatever, or to Hillary already, like, how does Bernie have any possible chance of overcoming that?
Repeat that question. It was my question. The super delegate.
Yeah, I agree. It's a big challenge.
Yeah. Let me phrase it another way.
Realistic.
Why should, and I'm gotten an argument with Ann about this, but why should people who aren't involved in a particular political party, who don't contribute 1 minute of their lives to it, have done nothing to foster it, don't pay dues to it, then decide who the candidates are of that political party? I think it's crazy to say that this is what the Republicans are doing. Is all of a sudden, like just the opposite, you can see what they ended up with. They said, oh, we won't have super delegates. We will just open it up to the Tea Party crazies.
But if
you know,
people want
to
Bernie,
choose our candidates.
If the people want Bernie, they can't have Bernie because there's so many super delegates already pledged.
I went to the Green Party convention today. During the week, I looked up to make certain that my status as a member of the Green Party was up to date, and I could vote. And he's saying, well, we should just allow people who have done nothing for the Green Party decide who our candidates are?
So you're in favor of superdelegates, Charlie?
Yeah.
You are?
Oh. Yeah.
So the voters don't get a say?
Well.
Yes, Jonathan.
Vote.
I'm not going over someone here.
Yeah.
Does anybody?
Mike,
yeah,
you
know,
you typed out. Jonathan.
That was my
Slovakian. Huh? Jonathan Barton.
Yeah. In other parts of the industrialized world, that's the exact reason why they have public financing for campaigns, open media time for candidates, instant runoff voting, proportional representation. They have no electoral college. They have paper ballots for every vote. And they also have a write-in candidate option that is actually used and a no-confidence vote option that is used on a regular basis. So
we, the Green Party of the United States did not drop out of the sky. I was a member at the time, and we put together 50 separate state parties.
Oh, I see.
And did the legal work and established a Green Party of the United States and got ourselves on the ballot. You do nothing and you want to decide. I'm going, these people did nothing and now they're voting and deciding who our candidates are?
Well, just as a follow-up, I've never heard a Green Party presidential candidate allowed in any debate, so that great work that you did is, being obstructed by the two other parties because of some of those things that I just mentioned, not being allowed to finally be the law of the land. The will of the people on any poll taken on this say those are things we all want.
Yep.
And the two major parties that we always say, well, we have to choose the lesser of two evil after the Green Party is
question
pushed out.
Okay.
It's a secular thing every 4 years.
Question.
There were 48 people running for president of the United States in New Hampshire. There's thresholds and cutoffs for getting on the ballot. I did give you the story about the Greens. I wasn't terribly thrilled with the idea of forming a Green Party. but I know about it, and they did it. And not everyone is invited to the party. They were crying about that in the Republicans, you know? They had the kiddie table, you know.
Well, let's move on. Yes, let's see, somebody who hasn't had...
These aren't easy questions.
Oh, here, Carl, you did...
I asked my question.
These are not... Oh, all right.
I had another one, but I...
You guys are...
Well, I just wonder, in addition to the president, if, say, Bernie Sanders elected or Hillary got elected or some Green Party got elected as a president, but the Congress, the Senate, and the House are controlled by the Republicans, what can you do as a president?
That's a very good question, a very big challenge. And actually, on the back table, the Robert Reich's endorsement of Bernie Sanders, he deals with that question, because the answer is you're right. You can't do that much, and Bernie and people have to watch out by saying, I'll do this and I'll do that, because they need the no Democrat will be able to do much unless, but if you have a person like Bernie, who's not taking money from the special interests and is working for the people, you may be able to win more of the votes in Congress, so you can do something. That's our best chance, but you're right. The president by themselves, they don't have a lot of power on domestic stuff.
One last question. How about you, Brian?
Thank you.
Have any of you ever...
I'm sorry, Tim, but you have the first question, and Dave hasn't had it. Am I taking
questions? Right. Yeah, we got more. What about this lady? What do you got?
Dave Rubin is next question.
What do you think of the Trump rally?
Yeah.
Several years ago, 10, 15, maybe more, I was very much involved in trying to get a Green Party introduced in this country. I see that over this time it hasn't exactly become the main political party in this country. I would like to ask Mr. Paidock if, since I have not done any work for the party in that time, should I be entitled to vote for Dr. Jill Stein in this primary?
Yeah, you can ask for a green ballot, and we're meeting. The information today was regarding getting her on the ballot. You know, so the fun thing that happened a few years ago was, they had three different ballots you can get when you go to vote, and you declare yourself a Democrat, a Republican, or a Green. And what happened was that somebody in your election commission printed the Democratic ballots were Green.
Yeah.
So we would go in and say, I would like a Green ballot. And you'd be handed this ballot. And it would have names like Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders on it. Because it was a Democratic ballot. Green, but Democratic.
Still the same way.
Is it? Yeah. All sorts of arguments would ensue that people would say, I want a green ballot. The election judge would say, well, sir, I just gave you one. You're holding it. And he said, that's not a green ballot.
What? Are you colorblind?
Todd, we'll share. Stand up, Todd.
No, I can speak out. This is for Charlie in brokered conventions. I just want to preface it by saying I've been listening to Washington Week, and, you know, there's a lot of former presidential candidates, Romney and McCain, that have come out publicly and put down Trump's candidacy. He needs 1237 to capture the Republican seat. But it seems like with all the Super Tuesdays coming up, that they want to bring him down. They don't want him to be get to 1237. That means that I think the Republican convention may be brokered. Does that mean, they're hoping that Rubio drops out, so it's between Cruz and Trump. Does that mean when Republicans get together, they're going to have a lot of off-floor, smoke-filled meetings about picking their candidate to run for the presidency?
Any brokered convention. I've been to any number of union conventions, which are all brokered, so I can speak with some experience. Yeah, there's deal cutting and promises made and offices. And yeah, all kinds of stuff starts happening, you know. And may the best man win, and promises and deals, you know, I'll take care of you. Yeah, if there's a brokered convention and if you guys are there, I'm going to take care of all you guys.
Ellen.
Don't worry.
Ellen Harrow, you're not waving at the waitress.
What do you want?
Do you think that Bernie Sanders can really win against either Trump or some other Republican?
I gave you the data. He beat her, beat Trump, both Hillary. I gave data that said the polls that both Hillary and Bernie beat Trump by 10%.
Can I ask a follow up to Ellen's question? What's your source for that, Charlie?
That was 270 to win. They gave you is what the website called, and it had the polls. That was CNN or somebody like that. It's called 270 to win.
Don't buy it.
And they gave you all the polls, and they were all like that, Don. There were several. That was only one.
Like Gallup polls. And
yeah, they have the CNN, Fox, and. I didn't print them all because it was a little hassle to copy and paste, but that was representative.
I was just going to add that what Charlie says. I support what you're saying. That I don't know if I brought the copy with me, but I could email you a copy if you want of three or four national polling organizations. And it was 11 polls. It wasn't just one fluke that Bernie won.
But the thing right now is that the Republicans are getting record turnout in these primaries.
Only because they got any contests going.
That's a good
Without the contest.
That one's right.
You mean because of the contest of all the candidates?
Well, yeah, you saw the argument the other night. There's no, you know, I mean, come on. People like this insult Blood exchange sport. And... You know, and then I watched Bernie and Hillary, and they're kind of like saying the same thing. I saw the same candidate. It's not argumentative. They got like they even really have stuff to argue about. You know, I mean.
Mary Bennett has not had a question yet. Mary.
Ellen, hang on.
Primary, Ted Cruz is within 100
votes behind Donald Trump.
Are you referring
to the Alligator? What I find interesting is that Rubio, which I think is going nowhere, has 116 delegates. If Rubio, drops out, I think, at Kasich, unless he pulls this miracle that, next Tuesday, he's out. Delegates they have accumulated combined, Donald Trump and Ted Cruz on an even keel. So,
is that a question?
You know,
okay.
I one quick thing. Ellen, these guys are looking at that, and they're saying that Trump, you have to realize that Republicans are a minority party. They're 29%. Less than that 29%, what is it, half of that is supporting Trump. And then when you go up against big mainline Democrats, you know, they're saying we're not going to win anyway, so why bother with this? This guy isn't going to beat those two. There's another, believe you me, you're talking about seasoned politicians, they don't want to waste money and time and effort on a thing that doesn't even look like it's going to get better.
All right, Mike Lehman is the next.
Okay. And that's going to have to be our final question, just getting into rebuttals here before.
Okay, I have a two-part question.
Are you at, Mike?
Whenever I look up Hillary and lies on Google, it's only about Benghazi. And isn't it the ambassador's choice to leave the country? Or some other people's? Why would she even be bothered? And the ambassador should pick up and leave when there's a civil war and bullets flying. What is she lying about besides that issue alone? It seems like that's the only thing. Is there something we're missing? What other lies? That's my first question. And second, please explain why superdelegates are better than the Republican way of not having superdelegates. Because I don't know if it was clear.
Two-part questions.
All right.
Why is Hillary a liar?
Why is Hillary's not a liar. There's nothing liar.
Well, what are they saying in the media?
They've been dragging this on, and I think there's a fatigue factor on the whole emails and this Benghazi, and nothing has come out of it, despite all the congressional hearings. If you got anything, come on. This is.
So that's it, just those emails and this silly Benghazi.
You
should have got the hell out of there. He's responsible.
I don't even know the details. All I know is, how long is it going to drag on? It's like Bernie said, how long are we going to hear about these stupid emails?
Yeah. So that's it. Just emails.
And then again, the other thing is, why don't you get people engaged? The question I have is, sir, why are you not affiliated with either a Democrat, Republican Party, Green Party, or one of those? I gave you a whole list of third parties, and you don't want to join any of them. You don't want to do anything, but then you want to show up and start telling us who should be our candidates. You just show up one day.
The Republicans don't.
And you want a place at the table.
Okay.
Get out of here. I gave you. When was the last Green Party you were at?
Well, the
last meeting.
And now,
a bit too busy, huh?
It is time for our rebuttal period. How many have opinions and news?
Yes. Just us applaud and thank the speakers.
Thank you.
Thank the speakers.
Charlene. Good job. Yes, Dave Rubin.
Except Mike, what's your back there?
No, come up here and
make it here.
You need to.
You can't. You can put
on the microphone. Or speak louder, maybe.
You know, it's my opinion that most of our Democratic and Republican people have it all wrong. Everybody keeps saying about how our country's going down the toilet, how we're losing jobs, how we're taking things out of context, how Empire America is bad for the world. Well, I'm here to tell you that it is still a strong nation. It is still the largest of the next six economies combined.
Yeah.
Our biggest problem is we don't know how to act like a grown-up. I see the United States, and it's typically that of a 17-year-old. Everything's always good, and then everything's always bad. With the same emotional range as a typical 17-year-old. We're a young empire on the world. We still haven't quite figured out what we're doing or where we're going. But I'll tell you something. Our next president has better be a smart one. Whether you like it or not, the empire of the United States still is probably the best hope for peace in this world. It is still the best hope to keep the sea lanes open, the goods are flowing, and globalization are going. And you know, Charlie, you may think that capitalism is a bad thing. It's been delivering the goods for over 300 years. And yes, I can statistically prove it. 300 years ago, all the world was poor. They got a lot more better off now. And frankly, you want your decent paying jobs, you let companies grow, you let companies go up, and then if you need good paying jobs, you get your workers organized.
USA!
Most of the people in this country, I have never yet seen a socialist create a new job for anybody. But yet I can go down the street at almost any of these smaller businesses and see booming people, see people being in their creative things. Thank God the small business owners of America haven't gotten your doom and gloom message about how bad America is. Thank God our immigrants haven't gotten that doom and gloom message, because fortunately, they're the people that are going to keep this country great.
USA!
You have to remember, the empire of the United States needs to act like an empire and promote peace and stability through democracy. Three things: keep the sea lanes open, keep the goods a-flowing, and keep globalization a-going.
USA!
Yay!
Viva USA!
Hey, Tim, you looked out warfare.
We won't have it when we keep the ceilings open, our goods are flowing, and the globalization are going.
Arms distribution. Hey, one fool at a time, y'all. Made in USA.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
Well,
loud.
My name's David Rubin, and that is a very tough act to follow, and so I will try. But the gentleman earlier explained that there will be 100 million projected casualties in some form or other because of cancer throughout the world. Some of those, I suspect, we know will be Muslims. We have a presidential candidate, Mr. Trump, who would refuse entry into this country of all Muslims. What kind of president, what kind of person in this country would refuse millions of people who are fleeing their country because of air pollution? My opinion, the man is clearly unfit for the presidency of the United States. If you may realize, most of you here, there was a man by the name of Colonel Pulaski, who came to this country in Poland, from Poland. There's a Polish person back there, he was one of the reasons we have this United States of America, which I do cherish every day. Without this Polish immigrant, we might not be here. And later on in our history, in the 1850s, there was an Irish potato famine that you all know about. Many Irish people came to this country, were welcomed here, and thank God lived here, survived, and I suspect some of their descendants are in this room. Thank God.
One of them is.
Thank God that this country allowed them in. And besides, I do happen to like a Guinness every so often. My great-grandparents came here from Ukraine when it was the Ukraine between the years of approximately 1905 and 1920. This was because first of the initial ones were because of pogroms against the Jewish people, and I'm one of them. This country, bless it, what allowed us to come here, and I know way back when there were problems for the Jewish people. Most of them have subsided. Imagine if back then Congress or President decided not to admit Jews who were being slaughtered during the pogroms, such as my great-grandfather. It's been said many times before. I do want legal immigration. I do not want illegal immigration. But I'd say anyone who says this religion, are not eligible to enter this country, even if you happen to be 3 years old, are unfit for the presidency of the United States.
Yes. All right. All right. All right.
About 50 years ago, I discovered rape. Little kids are doing something dangerous, like playing with fire or hand over a porch railing. What you do is act like you're going to stick their hand in the fire, at least close enough that they can feel it's hot. You know, if they're hanging over a porch railing, you act like you just grab them and let them see on the ground. Oh, about 2 feet further down, and they cut off the game, and you can holler at them as much as you want. You're not doing any good. But you can holler at them as much as you want and not accomplish anything. You let them see something for themselves. It's a little harder with adults, because adults have their preconceived notions. And it's a little hard to get an adult to see something for himself. But what I figure about Donald Trump and all his anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim rantings, he's just giving the Republican establishment a little more than at once of what it's been doing for the past several years. And now he makes them confront what they've been doing. I don't think lose the election over it, but I hope it's possible.
All right, Bill.
Thanks, Charlie, and I forget your name, I'm sorry.
Michael,
thanks for your, thanks for your presentation. Many of you will know that I'm not voting for anyone. Because this electoral system of ours is a gigantic fraud, as I've said many times before. So the best thing for us to do is to not participate in it at all. And I'd like to review a little history very briefly. Since the end of World War II, which is a period of 7 years, we've had 12 presidents. I looked it up. None has turned this country away from the priorities of Wall Street, the military-industrial complex, the national security state, and towards the interests of the people. Only one has seriously challenged the establishment, and that was JFK, as I got into in my last presentation, and I'll get into it more next time. He wanted to stop the Cold War and the Vietnam War, and the establishment promptly killed him. After just a couple years into his, or 3 years into his term. A few years later, Robert F. Kennedy wanted to do the same thing, and they killed him. They killed him almost literally the minute he won the California primary and was on his way to the Democratic nomination and the White House. So we're batting 0 for 12 with presidents. The presidency is only one of three branches, and the other two are even more hopeless. We have no control over them. So this electoral game of ours is a losing game. I'm not exaggerating. That's the cold historical reality. Our government is, in fact,
the deadly instrument of the ruling class, of the ruling elite. And I put our government in quotes, because it's not really our government. So basically, we live in a tyranny, regardless of who is in office at any given time, and regardless of who anybody votes for. I'd like to read to you a brief passage from my book, The Racket and the Answer. And this concerns this guy named Edward Bellamy. He was a reformer in the Progressive Era. He wrote a book called Equality. He wrote it in 1897. Some people have known what this system of ours is about for a very long time. Many of us haven't learned yet. So the characters in this book are Julian and Edith Leet. It's a utopia. They're living in the future in a nice socialist society, actually. And they're looking back at the bad old days of the United States, how it was then in their day and how it is today, as a matter of fact. And very briefly, I'll just read a paragraph here. Edith Leet wonders why Edith Leet wonders why the people couldn't get ahead even though they held the reins of power through voting for the representatives. Julian explains to her the colossal sham of our pretended popular government in America. In the old America, the capitalists, and you can stick in some other term, billionaires, ruling class, Wall Street, whatever, they talk in terms of capitalists. The capitalists controlled the government, which they needed to do to put through their self-enriching schemes. And Julian says, immense sums under the name of campaign funds were raised in order to galvanize the people to a sufficient degree of interest in the election to go through the motion of voting. But you must remember, if you would understand how absolutely the capitalists control the government, that a president, a congressman, or a mayor was only temporarily, that is during election periods, a servant to the people or dependent on their favor. His permanent, lifelong, and all-controlling interest was his livelihood. And that was dependent not on the applause of the people, but the favor and patronage of capital. And right now you can think of the Clintons, Bill and Hillary. Once they got out of office, they took literally tens of millions of dollars from Wall Street. This explains why our politicians and office holders, with few exceptions, and now you can think of Bernie Sanders, were vassals and tools of the capitalists. Edith concludes, really, it seems that the reason I could not understand the so-called popular system of government in your day is that I was trying to find out what part the people had in it, and it appears they had none at all.
Okay.
Julian concurs, if you only grasp firmly the vital point that the rule of the rich, the supremacy of capital interests as against those of the people at large, was the central principle of our system, you will have the key that clears up every mystery.
All right.
In 1960, Slim Brundage,
4 minutes.
One of the most known members of College of Complexes, wrote this letter in which he proposed a beatnik for president. This is a letter to Lawrence Ferlinghetti. Dear Lawrence, I'm sending you these posters in hope that you will use your clout to get a North Beach delegation to the convention. Hope to get the nomination myself, but you probably have a better chance than I on account you are known throughout the country. There will be no chicanery at the convention if I can help it, and I usually can't. Who gets the nomination is not of primary importance. The main objective is to lampoon the hell out of the powers that be.
Lampoon.
I'm sure we all have a hell of a lot of fun doing it, and we may even change some of the cherished beliefs of the squares. I read the modern meaning of that word that's most appropriate is to be the establishment, status quo-minded members of our community and the mainstream-minded who only watch corporate media to get their information, which is almost no fact in 2016 based on any independent study done by observers both domestic and international. As Mark Twain said, nothing can stand against the assault of laughter. Well, if you watched the Republican debate the other night, I'm surprised most of you aren't in the hospital from the laughter that exuded or the tears that brought out in those. Hoping to hear from you, I am yours for a better world, Slim Brundage, janitor. P.S. I have 2 publicity men on the payroll. I pledge their assistance to anyone who wins the nomination. I think it's important to lampoon them, but it's also important to say if we had real international laws enacted, all of us who supported the Iraq War, the Afghanistan War, the Patriot Act would be in Afghanistan or Iraq right now performing rebuilding reparations work. So here's one quote by George Orwell. If large numbers of we the people are interested in freedom of speech, there will be freedom of speech. even if the law is forbidden. If public opinion is sluggish, inconvenient minorities will be persecuted, even if laws exist to protect us. We can have all the laws and all the elections we want. If we don't establish what it means to be a peaceful, loving, equality, democracy, transparency, justice, respect for Mother Earth, cultivation of Mother Earth, and nurturing Mother Earth-based society, it's just making us feel good about all the failed captains that hit the iceberg over and over again in our lifetimes, as Ted just mentioned. When you're in a sinking ship, the civic equivalent of a sinking ship, you have to help the children and the women and the people with disabilities and the seniors who built this country into the lifeboats. And we're not that far from the shore. We're not out on the high seas. We can see how Scandinavia lives, and we're paying attention. I just hope that my fellow Americans realize that while my values, your values, are most represented by who's led on the corporate airwaves in Bernie Sanders, there's the sky's the limit for someone who represents all of our values, not just some of them that corporate media like MSNBC or CNN or Fox will let on and then dismiss him once Hillary's money takes over and Trump's fascism takes over.
Yes, I was listening now with interest, you know, to the comments about Donald Trump, and I could not think about those. You know, hotel workers in Las Vegas, you know, who were trying to form a union, and you had the Trump Organization basically stonewall their ability to negotiate, you know, an initial contract. The good news is that the NLRB had ruled that these hotel workers had an absolute right to form a union at Trump's hotel, almost from the moment that he announced. And I actually went through the disgusting habit of looking up his website, which was nothing but tweets. No evidence that he has really given thought, you know, to anything. It looked like one big PR scam, in my opinion. And the way he even presents himself should cause anyone who cares about individual liberty cause for concern. I agree with the gentleman that that immigrants have certainly enrich this country. But I also believe that that being part of, you know, the greater American population wasn't always easy. There were situations of anti-Semitism, anti-Catholicism, you know, what you have recently are our complaints about Hispanics, how they're, you know, how they're dealing drugs and bringing crime to this country. Where have we heard this before? We've heard it when the Irish, you know, came in here. We heard it when the Greeks and other, you know, Slavic, you know, countries, you know, came here. Oh, they're not as smart, or they're not as in the, I mean, the list goes on and on examples, of discrimination in this country. So we can take the good that this country has to offer, but acknowledge some of the bad as well. There's nothing wrong with that. And what I fear, you know, about someone like Donald Trump is that it encourages people who are inclined to discriminate anyway, who
people who don't quite look like them to really become even more violent, you know, and more oppressive toward those that are against them. So we don't have the luxury of not voting. And that's all I've got to say.
Next. All right.
Okay.
4 minutes.
Okay.
Clock's here.
First off, I hope the speaker who said this was being somewhat satirical. When he talked about how during the famine, the Irish immigrants were welcomed into this country. They were welcomed with ads in the Chicago Tribune for jobs, and it said at the bottom, no Irish need apply. They were welcomed during the Mexican War at the height of the famine, 1847. And even Irishmen who may have had a college degree, and there were some, were barred from being commissioned because, not because they had been foreign born, but because the establishment did not quite like their religion. In the mid-1850s, have you ever noticed when you've been in Washington, you've seen the Washington Monument, half of the monument is made of a stone with a heavier shade, a darker shade than the top. Reason being, the Know-Nothing Party, when they received a stone from the Papal States, and they put that into the Washington Monument, the Know-Nothing Party ripped down half the Washington Monument. It took 20 years, because of the intervention of the Civil War, it took 20 years for them to continue work on the Washington Monument, which is why you see the different shading there. It's literally a blot on our history that remains with us to this day. The Irish would have been second-class citizens for another half century, probably, if it were not for the Civil War. Because in the Civil War, once the shooting started, both sides needed whatever men they could find who had the intelligence and the ability not only to fight, but to lead. Tomorrow at the Irish American Heritage Center, as a matter of fact, they're going to have a book talk at 2 o'clock on a General Maher, an Irish-born general who was in effect kicked out of Ireland because of his Fenian sympathies, came to the United States, became a lawyer. When the Civil War started, he eventually worked his way up to Brigadier General, and he is known as one of the greatest American military heroes of that period. After the Civil War was over, Robert E. Lee, probably America's second or third greatest general, was asked by a newspaper reporter, not too much different than myself, and how the South could possibly have won the war when they had the better troops, the better leaders, and strong motivation. And Lee looked at the man and said, Lincoln had more Irishmen than I did. So much for, you know, how different groups have been mistreated and yet triumphed over that. The same story. Do you know who holds the greatest number? Who holds the greatest number of Medal of Honor winners? Not the Irish, not the Germans, Hispanics. Interestingly enough, check it out. The fact of the matter is these groups have all made significant contributions to this country at a time when those contributions were most needed. Now, I said earlier in one of my questions, I asked, what about dirigibles? What about blimps? Several people snickered. The fact of the matter is they use less fuel, they're safer than aircraft, they cost less, and it is easier to train pilots to, and I've been up in both a blimp and a dirigible. They're wonderful. They really are. They would be great for short distance and medium distance flights in the United States. End of our heavy dependence
on foreign countries for aircraft fuel because these machines use only a portion. Now, if you're talking about American independence from foreign oil, and if you're talking about America's ability to function on using less energy, less costly energy, this is a very, very good way to start. And I know that there are several people here that probably think I'm nuts and ought to go to the asylum.
No.
However, the fact of the matter is that if you check the figures out, and remember, dirigibles, now the difference between it, am I time up?
Yeah, your time's been up for about a minute.
All right. We'll talk about it.
One word. Thorium. One word. Thorium.
Just. Sir, I stand corrected, and I appreciate your comments.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Next fool's up. Let's let him speak.
How fast is the dirigible go?
Let's one fool at a time. Go ahead and speak.
How fast does a dirigible go? I think they can go about 200 miles an hour with
no 70.
Okay.
All right. Well, we'll research
in
that.
Your tree.
All right. So Illinois is going to vote on.
Carry your voice. Mic's off.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, Illinois is voting on the Ides of March, right?
Yeah.
March 15th?
Yeah.
Yes.
Florida, Ohio, Illinois, who else? There's like five states, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, so I want to have a little group participation here. And listen to the way how I phrase this. Not who you're going to vote for, who do you want to win the presidency? I want to show hands. Tim, help me out. Who's going to vote for Bernie? Because you guys are learned people, wise. Hold them up high. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, so 12 people want Bernie to win. How many want Hillary to win?
Oh, no.
One.
Zero.
No. One, two, three. Three people want Hillary. How many want Trump to win?
Yay!
One. How many want Cruz to win?
No.
How many want Rubio to win? Rubio?
Right now, out of all of them, I'd rather have Kasich, though, but I don't think he stands a chance.
Who do you want? Who wants Kasich to win?
I do.
I'll give those guys get a half. So we're by far a Bernie crowd here, huh?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think it's a shame, and Charlie defends superdelegates. I think it's a shame that Hillary's going to win presidency on a couple dozen senators and House of Representative people and governors, because it sounds like it's a bunch of wheeling and dealing just to stand behind Hillary. And I think the Republicans have it right without the Dallas superdelegates. And I think it's a shame that Bernie doesn't have a chance because Hillary is going to be nominated.
Okay, I'll be back.
They have to fall in line. They're all going to be behind Hillary.
Take a switch. And it's happened before.
Okay, we'll see. We'll see what the superdelegates are going to decide.
Next.
All right. I thought this is one of the most informative colleges I've been to in a long time. I learned more about the presidential election from this one lecture than I have from listening to 12 months of news reports. And that shouldn't come as a surprise. I think that it's not the news media's job to inform the American public. It's their job to return a profit to the shareholders. Now, since we're talking about the news media, those polls from CNN, Fox, etc., that you cited that show Sanders doing better than Clinton, if they run against Trump in the general election, Frankly, I'm rather suspicious of that, because first of all, who is more likely to vote, Democrats or Republicans? And that poll doesn't ask that kind of question. But if you look at how things have been going in the election so far, the Republicans have been turning out to vote in their primaries in record numbers. The Democrats, it's kind of so-so. It's nowhere near what it was in 2006 and 2008, which were banner years for the Dems. Now, this talk that the Republicans are a minority party, what is that based on? That this 29% figure, is that based on the number of people who actually call themselves Republicans? How many more people are there who say, I'm not a Republican, I'm an independent, and then they vote Republican? Now, if the Republicans are a minority party in this country, why is it that they have won most of the elections this decade? Why is it that both houses of Congress, most governors, and most state legislatures are a Republican majority? Now, Tim, you were talking about the United States and the American Empire as a force for peace. I would have to respectfully disagree with you. Oh, I see Tim's not here, but I'll just say that I'd have to disagree with Tim about that. That, as my friend Alan was pointing out to me, the United States caused the Iraq War, and that has in turn led to the rise of ISIS, which initially started out as a movement fighting the U.S. in Iraq, and that has since spilled over into Syria. I don't exactly see that as promoting peace. Now, Tim also said that denied that socialists have ever created jobs. I would say that socialists have created jobs in countries where there's been a socialist government.
Cities in this country.
Right. Well. Okay. Well, they had a social. That's right. Milwaukee had a socialist mayor. So it wouldn't just be countries. It would be places where there's been a socialist government. Now, as for Tim's talk about promoting democracy through empire, I don't think that's possible. I think that's a little bit like trying to put a fire out by pouring gasoline on it.
We're trying to hear.
Yeah, democracy and empire are in. I'll stop talking if somebody will stop
no,
the clock.
Keep going,
I'll stop
keep
talking.
Going,
and let
keep
them finish.
Going.
Okay, democracy and empire, because look, empire is one country saying, these other people over here, they don't have a right to choose their own government, so we're going to choose it for them. We're going to give them a government. Okay? That's the opposite of democracy. Now, to Pat, I like you a lot, you know, and one of the things we have in common is that we're both Civil War buffs. So I want to recommend to you, now, if you believe, it's a very common belief, in the history books, the idea that the South had better troops, generals, etc. And I believe that myself. But I just finished a book called I still got a minute to go, Tim.
Four.
Yeah, I got 1 minute to go. But let's not argue about it. Okay, the South had better troops. Okay, you said the South had better troops, generals, etc. There's a book that you should read, Pat. It's called The Myth of the Lost Cause, which says that. Which argues the opposite. You should definitely, and I recommend that book to anyone who's interested in Civil War history. It blows this idea of Confederate superiority right out of the water.
Alright. Well, 4 minutes, but we gotta make it quick because we gotta get out of here. It's 8:38. We got just a few minutes before 8:45. We gotta give our speakers a couple of times. Alright, Doug, go ahead. Last rebutter.
For those who don't know me, I'm Doug. So anyway, I'm not really going to talk about the politics of tonight, but some of the things that I heard, there was this thing about global warming, and it's true that, up in Alaska, they had the Iditarod, snow sled race, and they actually had to import snow to Alaska because there's so little snow up there. It was sort of funny. But at any rate, they were asking some people. I was watching something on Channel 11. They were asking people, is global warming basically because of humanity's fault, not caring about the environment? And to a person that was participating in the discussion, they said, no, we do contribute some, but I also heard that it's possible that the Earth could be shifting its polar axis. In other words, the south is coming more north, and then the north is coming more south. So we could be going through that kind of an experience, which would explain, you know, the impact of whatever all the scientists are pointing out for us. The other thing is, I heard this thing again, you know, let's go for minimum wage of $15. But the question I have to ask, are you guys willing to pay $5 for a cheeseburger?
Yes.
At McDonald's?
Yes.
$3 for an ice cream cone?
No. $15 and $5.
Hey, one fool at a time.
So at any rate, you know, that's going to be the result if they go all the way to $15. Either things are going to get more expensive for us seniors, or there's going to be fewer workers working in the fast food industry. And, you know, in a way, it's kind of crazy. I feel so sorry for those people. You go in there and you can have a hamburger 15 different ways, you know, and you have to tell the poor guy, well, I want it on flatbread. No, I want it on whole wheat bread or regular hamburger with or without poppy seeds. Now they got hot dogs at Burger King. You know, it's really crazy. These poor guys, you know, they probably should get 15, especially the guy that runs the register taking the orders. He should probably get $15 an hour. So the other thing is I heard this talk about, you know, we should be concerned about the quality of the air. You know, I heard, 52 million people could be dying. The thing is that, you know, we have an aging population. You know, the older population is the fastest growing part of the population. How many here are below under 50?
Close.
Under 50. Okay. Minority. All right. So all of us are over 50. Some of us are 60, like me. Somebody's 70 or 80. So, you know, by the time you hit 60 or 70, you've had a full life. So, you know, we shouldn't really worry too much about longevity because it's certainly working for the rest of us. Thank you.
Final statements from our speakers. Just be loud like you're in a campaign.
Okay. I just want to thank you all for your attention and for your very strong concerns. And I share your enthusiasm for making this a better world. And I just wanted to ask you, please, if you share my concern about keeping our health, water and air and climate safe, we're not going to die. I'm 76 years old, and I'm not going to go just because of some rich Republican or some selfish bureaucrat is going to. I'm not going to make my air dirty. I mean, who's going to stand for that? So let's all get together and think about whether Bernie Sanders would really be the one. And if you do think that, please pick up some of the papers in the back and share them with your friends. Bernie Sanders has got a high rating from the unions, from NAACP, from the Alliance for Retired Americans, from the League of Conservation Voters. There's a lot of people who have looked at his record. He's been going. Remember you saw the picture in the Tribune? Just about a week ago, he was being dragged off the University of Chicago campus for being in a civil rights demonstration. This man really goes back. And so please, if you like him, please, let's all work together and make sure we have the America we all can feel comfortable with. And let's, you know, call people, whatever you can do. It's really important. As you know, that as someone said, the turnout is low. People need to be excited. They have to know they make a difference. You can help. Thank you.
All right. Final statement, Charlie. Final statement, Charlie.
Well, 12 of you voted you feel the burn, and you are dismissed. You can go. The rest of you, I'd like you to stay here a while. All right. Hey, have some fun here. Get out there and vote.
Gavel yourself, Brom.
By the way, I'm supposed to put a plug in. If you want to volunteer for Bernie, let me know, and I got the info. They got places all over town, and all kinds of events. There's one tomorrow in my neighborhood, so
all right.
It's a fun campaign. All right, thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Go in peace and.
Come back. Good.
You headed back to
I'm on my bike.
Oh. All right, good one.